I welcome you all for this webinar series is conducted by Sri Ramchandra Institute of Higher Education and Research. Today we are going to have a big feast by Professor Dr. Shanmugasundaram on pericardial diseases. I like to introduce Dr. Prabhakar, who is the moderator today. He is an eminent cardiologist from Ashwin Clinic, Apollo First Med Hospital. He has special interest towards preventive cardiology, lipidology, and his contribution towards hypertension society and lipid association is remarkable. I'm passing over to Dr. Manohar for introduction of our speaker today. Thank you. Dr. Prabhakar, you can take over.
Thanks, Sada, for the kind words. Now, to introduce Dr. Shanmugasundaram to all is going to be a little difficult because he is a renowned teacher for all of us. Most of us would have trained under him. And he's been a highly academic person, excellent teacher. If he takes a class, you don't forget. Not only that, he's a very astute clinician, excellent in echocardiography, and he organizes conferences like it's nobody's business. Like the way he does a conference and does mega conferences, and does the scientific committees, chairpersons, everything is fine. Just to give a brief review about his topic today, pericardial disease has always been his passion. And in fact, when we selected to do some MCQs, he chose myopericardial disease. And it's so surprising that both of them landed up with Dr. Shanmugasundaram today. Pericardium has always been an enigma. Like, we have never known how much of pericardium and what is pericardium. It has always taken a backseat compared to the myocardium. And without wasting much time, I will hand over the session to Professor Dr. Shanmugasundaram to take over and give us an excellent academic piece for the evening. Sir, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Prabhakar. Let us have the pre-test questions now. Afterwards, I'll start my presentation.
Over to you, sir.
The poll is over, sir.
Yeah, poll is over. Like, how do I get the slides back? And I think you have to quit. Pritam? Yeah.
Sir, you have to share the screen. Share the screen, sir. You have to share the screen.
I'll close the polling. I'll close it.
Sir, now you try sharing, sir. I've changed the settings. You try sharing now.
1 second.
Just press the share screen and you will get it now, sir.
From my desktop, you know, the Zoom has disappeared, you know, searching for it.
Okay. You don't have to, sir.
Okay. Go down, sir. You'll be separate, sir. You'll be separate, sir. Go down. Go to the taskbar. Are you able to see, sir?
Right, I'm able to get it now. Okay, 1 second, one more second.
Yes, sir.
You okay now?
Yes, sir. Good, sir.
Okay, let me start off. Good evening to all of you. A word of caution in the beginning. This is likely to go on beyond 1 hour. So anybody who has preoccupied works beyond that 1 hour period, you know, you're welcome to leave the meeting because I don't want to curtail the presentation for the sake of time. As Prabhakar mentioned, pericardial diseases is one of the passionate topics for me. Pericardium becomes important for the cardiologist only when it is diseased. In spite of so many enumerated functions of the pericardium, there are two essential things, namely restraining the cardiac volume, particularly when you have acute volume overload of the chambers, and promoting the ventricular interaction. These are the two most important functions of the normal pericardium. But one can lead a near normal life without pericardium. The pericardial diseases are mostly the compression syndromes, fluid under pressure in cardiac tamponade, thick, rigid, inelastic pericardium. Both of these conditions interfere with the ventricular filling, resulting in elevation of filling pressures, causing this clinical presentation. Cardiac tamponade, there are certain atypical variants, namely low pressure tamponade and regional tamponade. Similarly, in constrictive pericarditis, you have certain subtypes such as subacute elastic compression, occult constrictive pericarditis, and transient constrictive pericarditis. Finally, we have a combination of fluid under pressure and constriction that's known as effusive constrictive pericarditis. In both cardiac tamponade and constrictive pericarditis, there is elevation and equalization of intracardiac pressures in diastole. That is quite a well-known fact for all of us. I would like you to enumerate certain other conditions, non-pericardial diseases, which may have similar hemodynamics. I'll give you just 10 seconds. You can enter it in a piece of paper. The diastolic equalization of pressures also occurs in certain other non-pericardial diseases, namely severe left heart failure, particularly acute decompensated heart failure, severe TR, acute severe TR particularly, acute RV dilatation as in RVMI and pulmonary embolism, and acute mitral regurgitation. What is responsible for this hemodynamic feature to occur on all these conditions is normal pericardium has no adequate time to yield, and then the restraining of the chambers occurs. So the normal pericardium becomes a constricting pericardium whenever there is an acute overload of the heart. This is one of the favorite things which my mentor used to teach us, Dr. Sivarajan. Whenever somebody comes with dyspnea and features of heart failure, if he has a hyperactive pericardium with very loud murmurs, consider valvular heart diseases. If there is hyperactive pericardium with prominent gallops with no or faint murmurs, think of myocardial diseases. If you have somebody with quiet pericardium with no murmur and no gallops, consider pericardial diseases. It's a very valuable statement which helps you to diagnose pericardial diseases at the bedside. You know the anatomy, the entire heart except a small portion of the left atrium is enclosed within the pericardial cavity. You have visceral pericardium, which is a serosa layer, and parietal pericardium, which has a serosa lining as well as a fibrous outer component. In between the two serosa layers, you have the pericardial cavity, which contains about 15 to 50 ml of fluid normally. Can you tell me where the transverse sinus of pericardium situated? Is it behind the left atrium, behind the great vessels, or around the root of the aorta? The transverse sinus is the cul-de-sac behind the great vessels. If you look at the pericardium, it is a continuous reflection on the entire heart. There are two areas of the heart which are not covered by pericardium, where the pericardium gets reflected on itself, but having recess or the cul-de-sac, the one which is behind the great vessels is the transverse sinus. The one which is behind the left atrium is the oblique sinus. Why should we bother to know about this? This will give you a little better idea of where the transverse sinus is situated and where the oblique sinus is situated. In addition to these sinuses, you have small recesses at the root of the SVC, at the root of the aorta, and the root of the pulmonary artery. They all serve as reserve volumes when fluid accumulates. Normally, they don't have, it's a potential space. These are all potential spaces. When fluid accumulates, they act as a reservoir or a reserve volume for the pericardium to accumulate more and more fluid without elevating the pressures. More than that, if you look at the echocardiographic tracings, it's a transthoracic, and these are all transesophageal echoes. Behind the left atrium, you see an echo-free space. This is the transverse sinus. Even in the absence of fluid collection, it may show up like this, and it may create a false impression that it could be an aortic root abscess even. When there is fluid collection, it may mimic like dissection of ascending aorta. Oblique sinus gets it's shown up only when there is fluid collection, otherwise it will not show up. So you should remember that these potential spaces may mimic as pathological features at times. Coming to cardiac tamponade, it's a compression disorder of the heart because of accumulation of fluid, blood, clots, pus, and gas singly or in combination, resulting in impairment of filling of ventricles. The pathophysiology of tamponade happens depending upon the amount of fluid, how rapidly the fluid accumulates, what is the nature of the pericardium, and what is the nature of underlying heart diseases. All these four factors determine the clinical occurrence of tamponade. If you look at the volume pressure relationship of pericardium, in an acute situation where there is a rapid fluid collection, it's quite steep. pericardium has no time to lengthen and accommodate more amount of fluid, in contrast to chronic effusions where the pericardium slowly stretches and accommodates more and more volume of fluid in the pericardial cavity without rise in pressure. The pericardium, if it accumulates more fluid, the pericardial pressure gradually increases and it matches up with the ventricular filling pressures. You know about the concept of transmural pressure. Transmural pressure is the difference between the left ventricular or right ventricular filling pressure and the pericardial, intrapericardial pressure. In a normal individual, LV filling pressure is about 12 millimeter of mercury. The intrapericardial pressure, I'll just put it as 2 millimeter of mercury. So the ventricle is able to fill up easily. In contrast to tamponade, where the intrapericardial pressure is elevated and it is going to approximate with the filling pressures. So the transmural pressure approaches zero. So when the transmural pressure becomes zero, you have the critical tamponade with all its florid manifestations like pulsus paradoxus, hypotension, shock, etc. Two ways it may behave. Rapid effusion, mostly occurring in situations like iatrogenic bleed, trauma, cardiac rupture in MI, dissection of aorta. Generally, this is called surgical tamponade. And most of the infectious illnesses and connective tissue disorders, uremia, malignancy, they take time to accumulate more and more fluid and late rise of pressure occurs. So this is J curve, which is very narrow and steep. This is a broad J curve, which is slow effusion. You can accumulate as much as 1 liter of fluid without rise in pressure. Here, as little as 200 ml of fluid can accumulate, resulting in tamponade. Now, you might have vaguely heard about this term, creep. Pericardium is a viscoelastic structure. Viscosity is a property of fluid. Elasticity is a property of solid tissue. Most of the cardiac elements, including the pericardium, valves, myocardium, supposed to have properties of both viscoelastic properties. Creep is one of the viscoelastic properties. How do you define creep? Is it a time-dependent change in strain? Strain is the deformation with an application of constant load, or it is time-dependent reduction of stress by application of constant strain. Which one of the two statements is true? Creep is time-dependent change in strain with an application of constant load. Look at the elastic band, which gets stretched. When you apply a constant load, the deformation occurs. Suppose you keep the force constant for some more time, the elastic band will stretch some more. That is known as stress relaxation. That means by applying constant strain, the stress comes down. Pericardium has both the properties, creep as well as stress relaxation. This picture will give you the basic idea of what happens in cardiac tamponade. Fluid accumulates under pressure. When right ventricle gets filled up during inspiration, the septum bows towards the left ventricle, impairing the left ventricular filling. Contrary occurs in expiration. So exaggerated ventricular interdependence or interaction is the characteristic picture of both tamponade as well as constrictive pericarditis. These are all the basic hemodynamic features. The pressures are elevated. The RV pressure, LV pressure, RA and LA pressure are all nearly equal in diastole. Stroke volume declines because impairment of filling occurs. So obviously the stroke volume comes down, compensated by increase in heart rate. In spite of increase in heart rate, cardiac output declines after some time. You have the phenomenon of pulsus paradoxus and what is known as unimodal systemic venous return. You know, this has appeared in the pretest question. The atrial filling occurs only during systole. In diastole, there is not much of filling. Another phenomenon which is happening is discordance in ventricular filling. Let us see how pulses paradoxes occurs in cardiac tamponade. Now, look at this cartoon. This is lung. This is pericardial cavity. This is cardiac chambers. Now, all 20 millimeter of mercury in diastole, RA, LA, RV, LV, intrapericardial pressure, and the pulmonary vein, systemic venous pressures are all 20 millimeter of mercury. When the patient takes a breath, intrathoracic pressure comes down. It gets reflected onto the pericardial cavity, reducing the intrapericardial pressure a little bit. This will allow a surge of venous return from the systemic veins into the RA and right ventricle. Right ventricle fills at the cost of left ventricle. Septum bows towards the LV. This interferes with the LV filling. Not only that, look at what happens at the pulmonary venous end. Remember that pulmonary veins are extra pericardial but intrathoracic, in contrast to systemic veins, which are extrathoracic as well as extra pericardial. Since pulmonary veins are intrathoracic but extra pericardial, during inspiration, the pulmonary venous pressure declines markedly. This results in a lesser gradient or reversed gradient from pulmonary vein to left atrium. This is another responsible factor for underfilling of left ventricle. So augmented right ventricular filling, lessened left ventricular filling, both would contribute to decline in systemic arterial pressure or pulse pressure during inspiration. Previously, people thought that cardiac tamponade is an all or none phenomenon. All features like pulses paradoxes, decline in cardiac output, equalization of pressures occur at one particular moment. But now, with the advent of echocardiography, with the features of echocardiography, we have now realized that cardiac tamponade is a continuum. It starts somewhere in phase one itself, where the intrapericardial pressure is gradually rising. First matches up with the right heart pressures, then matches up with the left heart pressures. Look at what happens to the cardiac output. Even before equalization, the cardiac output tends to gradually decrease. Marked decrease occurs in phase three. Similarly, inspiratory reduction of arterial systolic pressure. This is femoral arterial systolic pressure. Inspiratory reduction of the pulses paradoxes starts occurring well in phase one itself, becomes manifest well in phase two and phase three. So by definition, even though we call it as 10 millimeter or more reduction of systolic pressure during inspiration is called as pulses paradoxes, some degree of pulses paradoxes tends to occur well ahead of the clinical manifestation or the clinical definition. This tells you the same phenomenon. In phase four, the pericardial pressure, instead of being minus or plus one, plus two, it becomes plus 8 millimeter, matches up with the elevated right atrial and right ventricular pressure. Right heart pressures and the intrapericardial pressure are still lower than the left heart pressures now. This is the time you tend to have right atrial and right ventricular collapse. Now, the further increase in pericardial pressure occurs, all 14 millimeter of mercury, now pulses paradoxes occurs. Further increase in intrapericardial pressure, phase three, marked rise in filling pressures, so the cardiac output declines. So the cardiac tamponade is a continuum rather than a discrete feature. Let us now understand how the atrial filling is confined only during systole. Some of you have answered the other way around for this pretest question. Now, the same cartoon, pericardial pressure and the intracardiac pressure are all equal 20 millimeter of mercury. When the ventricle contracts, the intraventricular volume comes down, so pericardium has more space now. Since the space is increased, the pressure is going to decrease in the intrapericardial cavity. Since the intrapericardial pressure declines during ventricular systole, augmented filling of atrium occurs from the systemic veins as well as from the pulmonary veins. What happens at the end of systole? By the time the atria get filled up, so again, the intracardiac volume comes back to this stage. So the intrapericardial pressure, instead of being now from 20 millimeter, it comes to 18 millimeter, now comes back to 20 millimeter. So when the ventricle starts relaxing, it meets up with elevated intrapericardial pressure. So the filling is going to be sluggish. It's not going to be absent. It is going to be sluggish or slowed down. This is responsible for the slow wide descent or the shallow wide descent in cardiac tamponade. This is the other hemodynamic hallmark, reciprocal filling of ventricle. Look at the simultaneous pressure tracing aorta and the right ventricle. When aortic pressure declines during inspiration, the right ventricular pressure increases. In inspiration, right ventricle gets augmented filling, so the RV pressure increases, but LV filling is impaired, so the arterial pressure or the aortic pressure declines. This is called as pronounced or augmented ventricular interdependence. Same thing happens, LV pressure comes down, RV pressure increases. After pericardial synthesis, that phenomenon goes away. The clinical features, the symptomatology is remembered by the word chaser. C for chest pain, H hypotension, cardiac arrest, shortness of breath, incidentally detected echocardiographic effusion, or right heart failure. The clinical presentation, you have edema, elevated JVP. Though we expect X wave to be very prominent at the bedside, most often what happens is you see some vague pulsations without pronounced positive or negative features. That's what you generally get it at bedside. Though pressure recordings will reveal pronounced X descent and shallow Y descent. This is how the pulsus paradoxes manifest. Actually, the pressure tracing belongs to an individual in whom acute tamponade happened because of the coronary arterial rupture during percutaneous procedure. During inspiration, how significantly the arterial pressure drops. Sinus tachycardia will be a manifestation. Narrow pulse pressure. Remember, most of the chronic tamponades, it is not the hypotension that is going to be important. It is the narrow pulse pressure and tachycardia that are more important. How to make out pulses paradoxes, how to quantify pulses paradoxes at the bedside is an important thing. You estimate the systolic arterial pressure by palpation, increase the cuff pressure 20 millimeter more than that, gradually decline the cuff pressure, auscultate for the coronary sounds. The first sound appear at 108 millimeter of mercury now. Now, for some time, the coronary sounds will be heard only during expiration. During inspiration, when the arterial pressure comes down, you don't hear a sound. So intermittently, the sounds will be heard. And at one point, you will hear the coronary sound continuously for all the beats. The difference between these two values is going to be the quantified value of the pulses paradoxes. This is about 108 millimeter of mercury. This is about 90 millimeter. It's about 18 millimeter is the pulses paradoxes. This is how you quantify it at the bedside. But much more practical way is what is known as oximetry paradoxes. Look at the waveform during inspiration, nicely declining. If the ratio between the pulse wave height in expiration to inspiration exceeds 1.1, it is supposed to indicate tamponade. Look at the sensitivity, much higher than the clinical detection of pulses paradoxes, almost 89%. Remember, both pulses paradoxes and the oximetry pulses paradoxes are sensitive ones, but not specific, because pulses paradoxes can occur in so many other conditions. Pulmonary embolism, RVMI, severe obstructive airway disease, hemorrhagic shock, ascites, obesity, etc. All these conditions, what happens is there is either wide fluctuations of intrathoracic pressure like asthma, obesity, ascites, etc. Or the pericardium is constraining the chambers as in pulmonary embolism and RV myocardial infarction. Pulses paradoxes may be absent in spite of tamponade. Whenever LV is diseased, LVH, LV dysfunction, uremia, severe aortic regurgitation. In atrial septal defect, where the atrial septal defect will allow augmented filling or a constant filling of the right ventricle in spite of respiratory swings of pressure. In pericardial adhesions and regional tamponade also, you will not get pulsus paradoxus in spite of tamponade. Severe right ventricular hypertrophy is another condition where you won't make out pulsus paradoxus in spite of other features of tamponade. Beck's triad, no longer talked about for obvious reasons. It's a combination of falling blood pressure, rising venous pressure, and distant heart sounds. Beck's triad is uncommon in contemporary practice, main reason being echo is available easily, so you detect pericardial effusion even before tamponade or early tamponade, insidious onset of effusion, higher prevalence of systemic hypertension, or rarity of pyopericardium in the present era. Which one is appropriate answer? It is insidious onset of pericardial effusion is the right answer, because most of the effusions which we encounter in contemporary practice is medical tamponade, where fluid accumulates slowly. So the Beck's triad is not going to be manifest at the bedside. Remember that 1/4 of people with tamponade will present with elevated systemic arterial pressure. Heart sounds need not be muffled, and you may even hear a pericardial rub in spite of tamponade. Claude Beck is the surgeon, first professor of cardiothoracic surgery in the US who had described this way back in 1935. What is surprising is those days, because he had called it as triad of falling pressure, rising venous pressure, and small quiet heart, because most of the causes those days were bleeding into the heart, pericardial cavity, penetrating wounds, rupture of heart in different conditions, rupture of aorta, etc. In contrast to the present day tamponade, where the medical reasons are going to be contributing. Surprisingly, Beck had also discussed about what is known as chronic cardiac compression triad, which is never talked about by most of the teachers. Yes, nicely and elegantly put it as chronic tamponade as high venous pressure, presence of ascites, and small quiet heart. This is Claude Beck. He has another attribute. He is the first cardiothoracic surgeon who has revived a person at the end of surgery when he developed cardiac arrest. Cardiac massage was given for about 45 minutes. Heart did not pick up. And finally, he used this external paddles, gave a shock for the first time in the history. And patient got around and went home alive. Electrocardiogram will give you sinus tachycardia, low voltage complexes, and non-specific TVA changes or significant T inversions as well. The question now is, alternance of QRS is known to happen. Is it pathognomonic of cardiac tamponade? Yes or no? The answer is no, because it is the total alternance. P should alternate, QRS should alternate, and T wave also should alternate to be diagnostic of tamponade. QRS alternance can occur in so many other conditions, like during SVT, soon after SVT, even post VPD, you can have QRS alternance, and acute severe ischemia can give rise to QRS alternance. So remember, total alternance in the ECG is pathognomonic of tamponade. Like what you see in this tracing, the P wave, the QRS, and the T wave alternate. Look at V2, even the polarity keeps alternating. Now, this is very important. If you encounter this sign, you are reasonably certain that you are encountering a patient with tamponade. The reason for alternation of PQRST is the heart is moving like a pendulum in a large pericardial sac, up and down. For no obvious reasons, it alternatively comes closer to the surface of the heart and goes away from the heart in the next beat. This is the reason, this is the mechanism which is proposed, but sincerely speaking, I do not know the reason, but it can happen, and it is very diagnostic of a tamponade. Chest X-ray, cardiomegaly, smooth rounded borders. You don't see bumps and humps in cardiac shadow, smooth rounded borders. Because of decline, stroke volume, LV and RV, aorta will be small, pulmonary arteries will be small, So the vascular pedicle will be narrow. Pulmonary vascular activity will be normal. There will not be interstitial or alveolar edema, remember. And pericardial effusion, sorry, pleural effusion may coexist. Because of narrow vascular pedicle and smoothly enlarged heart size, it may mimic a water bottle called as water bottle sign, not the present day water bottle. I think you should feel how a vintage water bottle will look like. This is a lateral chest X-ray. There is a subtle sign of pericardial effusion here. What is this sign known as? Carefully look at the lateral view. Something is there, very subtle sign, but very important one. This is what I meant. The epicardial pad of fat will cast a translucent shadow between the epicardium, the heart shadow, and the pericardial shadow. You can see the shadow here. This is known as Oreo cookie sign. And how does it help, when you do a pericardial aspiration in cardiac cath lab? If you happen to see this fat sign, it's not seen well in PA, but look at the lateral view. You can see the pericardial fat oscillating to and fro. If you could see it in PA or lateral view, when you introduce your needle, see to that you push the needle away from the the pericardial fat's linear shadow. So this is how it's important in the practical manner. Echocardiography, gives you an idea about the presence of fluid all around or loculated, how much fluid is there, is it clear fluid or turbid fluid. And it also sometimes tells you the etiology. Here, so you see the metastatic deposits here, malignant pericardial effusion. How do you quantify it? Simple way is measure the distance between epicardium and pericardium posteriorly in diastole. If it is less than 10 mile, more than 20 is severe. You can also semi-quantitate the pericardial fluid in ML. You can calculate the cardiac volume in apical four-chamber view, and the pericardial volume, single plane method. The difference between the two will give you the pericardial volume in ML. I strongly recommend that every one of the people with significant pericardial effusion should go for CT chest. It gives a lot of information, most mainly about the loculations, pericardial thickness, and sometimes primary malignancy or secondary malignant deposits can be diagnosed. When you have nodes in the mediastinum, if the nodes are only in the mediastinum but not involving the hilar nodes, it is likely to be tuberculosis, because presence of hilar nodes should make you to think of non-tuberculous causes of pericardial effusion, namely lymphomas, secondary in deposits in the lymph nodes, sarcoidosis, etc. This is a patient with a very large effusion. No need to measure, it's a very large effusion. We get some idea about the physiology. The presence of tamponade is exemplified by the right atrial inversion or the right atrial collapse and subtle right ventricular collapse also. Again, one more example, large effusion, significant RV compression. I generally prefer a parasternal short axis view to make out this sign. Here, you can see a nice right atrial collapse. In addition, you can also see left atrial inversion. This is quite unusual echocardiographic sign. Since this patient has effusion extending behind the left atrium, this is actually the oblique sinus, which is filled up with fluid. You can see some degree of inversion of left atrial wall as well. This is made out in short axis view well. So this is left atrial collapse. Chamber collapse in tamponade is a very easy sign to make out. But the sensitivity and specificity are not going to be very great. Right atrial collapse will be more sensitive but less specific. Contrast, right ventricular collapse is less sensitive but more specific. RV collapse will be absent in pulmonary hypertension and right ventricular hypertrophy, obviously because the right ventricular wall will be thicker. Remember, right atrial collapse occurs in end diastole. Right ventricular collapse occurs in early diastole. You should remember about that, because right atrium, the volume and the pressure is least at end diastole. So RA compression occurs end diastole. It may extend into early systole. In right ventricle, the minimum pressure occurs in early diastole, so it gets compressed in early diastole. Left atrium and left ventricle may also show the collapse signs. I also prefer an M mode because it vividly gives you the presence of both normal systolic movement as well as the early diastolic movement of the right ventricular wall. This is the right ventricular early diastolic collapse. This is before aspiration, marked right atrial collapse and right ventricular collapse. Remember that a brief right atrial collapse is not suggestive of tamponade. It should occupy more than one third of cardiac cycle. So frame by frame, you go calculate how many frames right atrial inversion is present and calculate the frames for the entire full cardiac cycle. You will have an idea about how much portion of the cardiac cycle is right atrial collapse is present. After aspiration, right ventricular collapse disappears, right atrial collapse disappears. Yet another sign in Doppler, which is a more valid sign than the mechanical compression signs, is the flow paradoxes. I have already mentioned about the interventricular dependence. Right ventricle gets augmented filling in inspiration at the cost of left ventricle. So what happens at the transmitral Doppler? It shows inspiratory decline because during inspiration, LV gets underfilled. Contrary occurs in tricuspid Doppler. During inspiration, it gets more, the velocities become more. This is called as flow paradoxes. This is before pericardiocentesis. This is after pericardiocentesis. Now, I'm in constant touch with young colleagues because, they make you to think. A month ago, I had a similar talk on pericardial hemodynamics. One young colleague, who is as inquisitive as this child, asked me, "Sir, if venous filling of atria is unimodal with a shallow widening, how does ventricular filling occur at all? And how do you explain on top of it flow paradoxes?" At the time, I gave an answer which was not satisfactory to me even, but afterwards I thought about it, went through the stress tracing, it gave me at least partial answer. If you look at the pressure tracings, it will look as if during early diastole, the pressures are a little high, the ventricular pressures are not close to zero, it is elevated. The atrial pressure and the ventricular pressure are nearly equal. We think that ventricle cannot get filled up because of equal pressures in both atria and ventricle. But remember what happens in a normal heart in diastasis. Though small filling occurs, there is filling. About 5% of ventricular filling occurs in diastasis, where there is no gradient between atrium and ventricle. So somehow, in spite of lack of gradient between atrium and ventricle, you have some degree of filling. But look at the Doppler in tamponade. Overall, the flow velocities are less. Not only that, when the patient takes inspiration, look at the transmitral Doppler, the velocities come down a little more. Not only that, early diastolic velocities selectively become less. This is equivalent to your shallow widison, that is, decrease in filling. Or shallow widison in early diastole. In early diastole, the filling is affected. This becomes near normal pattern of transmitral Doppler in inspiration. So in inspiration, what happens in the left ventricle, this is reversed in right ventricle, so you get the neck vein findings accordingly. Look at what happens to the flow velocities across mitral valve. Once the tamponade is relieved, you get the normal pattern. Not only that, the velocities also now increase. What was close to 0.5 becomes now close to 1 meter per second. So in early diastole, what happens is atrial pressure, which is elevated, ventricular pressure is elevated. There is no big gradient between the two. So slow filling or little filling occurs in early diastole, and atrial contraction gives you little boost. So further filling may occur late in diastole. Though the normal respiratory variation is about 5%, the transmitral or the transtricuspid. To be more specific, people have defined that the difference between inspiration and expiration velocities should exceed 25%. There is a particular way of measuring that, whether it is for tricuspid or mitral flow. You need to calculate expiratory E velocity, subtract with inspiratory E velocity, divided by expiratory E velocity. So this is the way to go for both mitral and tricuspid velocities. But you know, the flow velocity paradoxes of more than 30% in mitral, more than 60% in tricuspid is virtually diagnostic of tamponade. But remember, cardiac tamponade is a continuum. I said 5% variation can happen in normal individual. So when somebody has pericardial effusion with 10% variation, 15% variation, 20% variation, obviously they are in mild tamponade. It becomes severe tamponade when you have the so-called cutoff, which is described in literature. Reciprocal filling of ventricle, look at the ventricular dimensions. RV becomes wider in inspiration, LV becomes narrower. Elevated venous pressure is evident in the form of IVC plethora. This is Doppler equivalent of pulses paradoxes. Aortic velocities decline markedly during inspiration. In contrast, pulmonary velocities may increase during inspiration. We have seen two examples of very large fluid collection with the tamponade features. Look at this example, mild to moderate effusion, but nice RV collapse and right atrial collapse. Probably this individual, you might have had rapid accumulation of fluid. So tamponade is present even with the mild to moderate fluid collection. Now, this belongs to an elderly gentleman, underwent bypass surgery 15 days ago, presents with dyspnea and pedal edema. Two unusual things are there in the echo. You need not worry about the bottom. Look at the 2D echoes and write down what are the two unusual things you notice. The two unusual things are, one is the presence of fluid only behind the left ventricle. There's no anterior fluid. But this much of fluid behind, you should have much more fluid than anteriorly. But this is an example of loculated effusion, lateral wall of LV and behind the left ventricle. And interestingly, one other rare sign, namely left ventricular diastolic collapse, very distinctly present here at the base of the heart, short axis, even in M mode. Generally, in regional tamponade like this, other manifestations like flow paradoxes and clinically manifest pulses paradoxes generally are not supposed to be present. But this individual, probably because of very large loculated effusion, he manifested flow paradoxes as well as the Doppler equivalent of pulses paradoxes was manifest. Regional tamponade, it can be regional adjacent to RA, adjacent to RV, or adjacent to LV. Usually occurs postoperatively. It's mostly because of the blood clots. Whenever it is non-surgical, think of adhesions with resulting in loculation. Remember, there will not be classical clinical features. You should suspect in a postoperative patient who manifest decline in arterial pressure. Sudden onset of systemic arterial pressure is the only clue to suggest that there may be a regional tamponade because of the presence of dressings all around. One may have to resort to transesophageal echocardiography occasionally to confirm the diagnosis of loculation, but most often you can get away with subcostal imaging in that. You are well aware of pericardial compression syndromes. Hope you have also heard about pericardial decompression syndrome, which occurs after pericardial aspiration. Something like what happens with the very rapid removal of fluid from the pleural cavity, one can develop pericardial decompression. What are the manifestations? Is it pulmonary edema, or is it fall in blood pressure, or is it RV dysfunction, or all of the above? It's actually all of the above. This is a publication in 2015, 35 published cases. 1/3 had acute pulmonary edema, 40% had presented with mild to moderate LVF, 9% had isolated right ventricular failure, 20% had biventricular failure, and 2 had non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. I do not know how non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema manifests in a person with cardiac tamponade after aspiration. But interestingly, in contrast to pleural aspiration, where a quick drainage of more than a liter results in pulmonary edema, here in this study, as little as 250 ml of drainage, 400 ml of drainage had resulted in this complication. Not only that, whether it was needle aspiration or surgical pericardiostomy, this phenomenon had happened. It occurred most often immediately. Generally, what happens is after pericardial aspiration, patient has manifest transient symptomatic improvement followed by worsening. The worsening may occur soon after the initial period of improvement, or it may be delayed as much as 48 hours. Here is an young lady with tuberculous pericardial effusion, marked fluid collection with florid tamponade features. After aspiration, one day later, look at what happens. She presented with, she was in the hospital. She manifested, bloated feces and elevated JVP. She was complaining, the initial improvement is no longer there. Now I'm developing, breathlessness again. This is about 24 hours after aspiration. Some fluid is there, but what is striking is right ventricular dilatation, right atrial dilatation, non-coaptation of the tricuspid valve, GRAS, non-pulmonary hypertensive TR, right ventricular dysfunction, only the apex contracts. Remember that this mechanical sign is not specific to pulmonary embolism. This happens with other conditions like RV myocardial infarction. Here, the pericardial decompression syndrome manifesting as right ventricular dysfunction. This patient underwent CT scan, and we ruled out pulmonary embolism in this patient. This is an example of pericardial decompression. At the time, the RV strain showed a marked decline, 9%. Fortunately, without much of an intervention, a week later, the right ventricular dysfunction disappeared on its own. Now, this two pressure tracings, A and B, in both before aspiration and after aspiration, both you have tamponade features, inspiratory reduction of arterial pressure, which becomes normal after aspiration. What is the difference between the two tracings? The difference is the arterial pressure. Look at this example B, where the arterial pressure is close to 100. Here, the arterial pressure is close to 70 or 75 millimeter of mercury. This is an example of low pressure tamponade. People who have hypovolemia, even moderate fluid collection with an intrapericardial pressure of about 8 millimeter or even 10 millimeter of mercury can produce manifestations of tamponade. Generally occurs with a dehydration due to vomiting, diarrhea, hemorrhage, cancer treatment, dehydration, diuretic therapy. All these things would be responsible for hypovolemia, which will be manifesting as low pressure tamponade. The diastolic pressures will be close to 6 to 12 millimeter of mercury only. On the contrary, you can also see people with hypertensive tamponade. I have already mentioned that 1/4 of individuals present with arterial hypertension. Classical features will be there, but arterial pressure will be close to 200. either due to pre-existing severe hypertension or because of increased beta adrenergic drive. Now, you know, somebody with large fluid, marked symptoms, there is no need to think about it. You know, immediate pericardial aspiration is the answer. But there are many people in your practice who come with large fluid, some of the signs of tamponade, particularly aria, RV collapse, but the patient looked very stable. How soon you should do pericardial aspiration? This algorithm, you know, published by ESC would probably be very helpful and practical. Give scores for the etiology, scores for clinical presentation, orthopnea 3, slow evolution of the disease minus 1, malignant disease 2, hypothyroidism minus 1. So depending upon the etiology and the clinical presentation, the scores vary. Similarly, the imaging findings also have scoring values. Put everything together. If it is more than 6, go for immediate aspiration. If it is less than 6, you can take your time, but do it within the next 12 to 48 hours. Pupil with the surgical tamponade bleed into the pericardium. Aspiration can save certain temporary situations like what happens in cardiac catheterization lab. But aortic dissection or cardiac rupture with bleed into the pericardium, generally it is advised not to remove fluid because it's going to worsen the leakage into the pericardial cavity. But as a temporizing measure, before the surgical theater is ready, slow periodical removal of blood from the pericardial cavity will be helpful to sustain the hemodynamics. One more practical thing in management, somebody with tamponade dyspnea, oxygen is being given. The physician assistant in the coronary in intensive care unit wants to give positive pressure ventilation. Is it justified? Remember that whenever the intrathoracic pressure increases, it's going to increase the intrapericardial pressure and it is going to worsen the right ventricular filling. So positive pressure ventilation has to be avoided. Now let us take a break of just 5 seconds. We will move on to constrictive pericarditis. What do you see in this picture? If somebody had located this board, I think I would call them as smart people. Now we'll go to constrictive pericarditis. Generally caused by thick, adherent, inelastic pericardium. But remember, as many as 20% of people with constrictive pericarditis will present with normal thickness of the pericardium. Can you tell me the causes of constriction with normal pericardial thickness, usual causes, two important causes? Radiation and post-cardiac surgery. Now, when somebody suffers from acute pericarditis, he can go in different directions. Pericardial effusion, tamponade, pericardial effusion can resolve. Pericardial effusion can go on for effusive constrictive pericarditis, subacute constriction, chronic constriction, then finally chronic LCP constrictive pericarditis. Fortunately, we don't get to see this, worse constrictive pericarditis now. How many of people with acute pericarditis develop constriction during follow-up? 1, 5%, 38%, or the answer is something else? Answer is something else because it depends on the etiology. Overall, 1.8% of people with acute pericarditis develop constriction, but purulent pericarditis and tuberculous pericarditis, about 1/3 may develop constriction. Neoplasm and immunological disorders, 2 to 5%, very less in viral and idiopathic causes. Again, starting off with hemodynamic features of constriction, the intracardiac pressures are elevated and equalized in diastole. You get dip and plateau pattern of ventricular pressure, the square root sign. Remember, this feature is present in tamponade, but plateau pattern will be present in tamponade. Unimodal pattern in tamponade, but bimodal pattern in constrictive pericarditis. You get steep X descent and steep Y descent in JVP as well as in the right atrial pressure waveform. In tamponade, during inspiration, the venous pressure comes down, but here venous pressure may increase, the so-called Kussmaul sign. So these are the differences between tamponade and concision. This is the typical square root sign. The ventricular diastolic pressure in early diastole dips down close to zero, quickly ascends up, and then becomes flat. This is called a square root sign. Echocardiography equivalent of square root sign is the type 3 restrictive pattern of filling across the atrioventricular valves. Again, exaggerated ventricular interaction. In tamponade, fluid under pressure. In constrictive pericarditis, it is inelastic thick pericardium. During inspiration, RV is overfill, LV is underfill, and contrary occurs in expiration. This is responsible for the reciprocal filling of ventricles. To recapitulate, there are many similarities between tamponade and constriction. In both, the filling pressures are high, the filling pressures are equalized, stroke volume comes down, compensatory tachycardia is there, JVP is elevated, edema is there. There is exaggerated respiratory variation of ventricular dimensions and the flow velocities, not only across AV valves, but also across semilunar valves, which we had seen in the examples already. I had already enumerated, but quickly recapitulate what are the differences between constriction and tamponade hemodynamically. Restriction of filling occurs in mid-late diastole. Early diastole, it is an augmented filling. In tamponade, it is pan-diastolic. Early diastolic pressure is low in constriction. It is elevated in tamponade. Square root sign is present in constriction, absent in tamponade. Venous filling is bimodal. X and Y descent are steep. M pattern or the W pattern in the pressure tracings are in the neck veins. In contrast, it is unimodal filling in tamponade. Kussmaul sign is present in constriction, not in tamponade. Actually, the inspiratory decline of venous pressure will happen. Pulses paradoxus may be present in about 20% of cases of constrictive pericarditis, particularly the subacute constriction. Tamponade, it is almost invariably present. Remember, the reciprocal filling of ventricle, the basic hemodynamic reason is for constriction, it is the difference between the LA or pulmonary venous pressure and the left atrial pressure that determines the reciprocal filling. But in tamponade, both situations like inspiratory augmented filling of ventricle and inspiratory decline of gradient between the pulmonary vein and the atrium are responsible. I'll show it with some cartoons. Hemodynamic hallmarks of constriction. Dissociation of pressures from intrathoracic to intracardiac because of pericardial shield. Pericardium does not transmit the intrathoracic pressures to the heart. That is most important hemodynamic hallmark. The second one obviously is the reciprocal filling of ventricles. Now, let us look at this situation where there is constrictive pericarditis. The pressures are all 16 millimeter mercury everywhere. During inspiration, the pulmonary veins are intrathoracic but extrapericardial. So when the lung alveolar pressure comes down, the venous pressure comes down. So the pulmonary venous pressure, instead of 16, it becomes 14. So it is actually reverse. Obviously, not much of pulmonary venous flow occurs in TLVA. So LA and LV are underfilled because of enclosure by inelastic pericardium, because of augmented right ventricular interaction, RV gets filled at the cost of LV. So RV gets filled more, not because of primarily increased flow from the SVC. It is primarily because of decreased flow from the pulmonary vein into the left atrium and left ventricle. This is where it shows a subtle difference from tamponade. In tamponade, it is the augmented systemic venous return as well as decreased pulmonary venous return that is responsible for LV underfilling. Here, the pulmonary vein to LA gradient is responsible. Look at the pressure tracings here, wedge pressure to LV pressure tracing. In expiration and during inspiration, the pressure difference between LA and LV is decreased. At times, it may even get reversed. In expiration, what happens? The intrathoracic pressure increases. The pulmonary venous pressure increases to 17. So there is 1 millimeter gradient from pulmonary vein to LA. So LA, LV get filled up much more easily. Ventricular septum gets pushed to the right ventricle. So RA and RV get underfilled during expiration. This is responsible for expiratory flow reversal in hepatic veins or the systemic veins. On the contrary, in expiration, look at what happens to the diastolic wave in pulmonary veins when compared to the inspiratory waves. The expiratory D wave shows actually an increase. So remember, in expiration, because of increased filling or easy filling to left heart, the D velocities increase. Here, the diastolic velocities on the right heart get decreased or may even get reversed. So this is number one hemodynamic hallmark, dissociation of intrathoracic pressure and intracardiac pressure. The pulmonary capillary wedge pressure or the left atrial pressure decreases. The left atrial to left ventricular pressure gradient decreases during inspiration, which is responsible for underfilling. The second hemodynamic component, reciprocal filling of ventricle, during inspiration, LV pressure comes down, but the RV pressure increases. Remember, it is not the peak pressure that is important. It is the area of RV pressure waveform and the LV pressure waveform from expiration to inspiration that gives better idea or more specific finding. In constrictive pericarditis, what happens? In inspiration, LV pressure comes down, but the RV pressure goes up. In restrictive cardiomyopathy, both LV pressures and the RV pressures come in the same direction. So people had looked at this ratio known as systolic area index, which is nothing but RV area divided by LV area in inspiration, that is divided by RV area by LV area in expiration. If it is more than 1, it is 1.1, it is diagnostic of constriction. There are certain other indices criteria. LVEDP and RVEDP, not exactly equivalent, but close to 5 millimeter, within 5 millimeter of each other, occurs in constriction. But in restrictive cardiomyopathy, LV diastolic pressure will be at least 5 millimeter more than RV and diastolic pressure. Pulmonary hypertension is a feature of restrictive cardiomyopathy, but pulmonary artery systolic pressure will not be elevated much in constrictive pericarditis. But look at all these previously described pressure tracing signs. They have very poor sensitivity and poor specificity. But look at this systolic area index. Surprisingly, 97% sensitivity and 100% specificity. The coming to echocardiographic signs of constriction, though it is a very old collection, almost 17 years, I would like to show this because I've never seen such a marked septal bounce in constrictive pericarditis. Not only ventricular septal bounce, look at the atrial septum, that is also bouncing to a certain extent. Persistently, it is towards left atrium, but in diastole, during inspiration, it shows further bulging into the left atrium. So both atrial septal bounce and ventricular septal bounce. As signs, MOD is very important in certain situations, particularly in constrictive pericarditis, there are certain subtle signs. Like what happens in dip and plateau in the cath lab, equivalent of it is rapid relaxation of LV, then becomes flat, the inverse square root sign. I mean, reciprocal filling of ventricle, what happens in inspiration? The septum gets pushed to LV. Not only that, look at the EF slope, better filling now in expiration. During inspiration, the EF slope comes down. These are all old MOD signs, but still valid. Look at the pulmonary valve. It shows premature opening of pulmonary valve. This is during expiration, but during inspiration, what happens is the RV end-diastolic pressure is so high, it opens up the pulmonary valve even during mid-diastole. So premature pulmonary valve opening is an important sign of constrictive pericarditis. Now, looking at the not just in interventricular septum, because of constant alterations of LV-RV pressure relationship, you get two important notches, early diastolic and during atrial systole. This is called as early diastolic notch. This is called as atrial systolic notch, otherwise known as Spanish notch. Both notches are present in constrictive pericarditis, will not be present in restrictive cardiomyopathy. Just look at the same patient's MOD echo after pericardectomy. The so-called notches have disappeared. Again, flow paradoxes like what you encountered in tamponade. By definition, more than 25% difference across mitral valve, more than 40% difference across tricuspid valve constitutes flow paradoxes. Remember, maximum change is going to happen with the first beat of inspiration. Liu Hatley, it's very important article. What happens to so many Doppler parameters, mitral e-velocity, tricuspid e-velocity, in normal individual during inspiration? It decreases by about 4%, increases by about 15%. What happens in restrictive cardiomyopathy? More or less the same, but in constrictive pericarditis, the e-velocity mitral valve declines to by 33%, tricuspid velocity increases by 44%. Similar thing happens with aortic velocity, ejection time, pulmonary velocities, and isovolumic relaxation time. But a practical thing is to look at the AV flow paradoxes. Reiterate again, maximal change, you should look at it at the first beat of inspiration. The so-called flow paradoxes nicely made out, and after pericardectomy, it becomes subtle or almost absent. Remember, in contrast to cardiac tamponade, where the velocities are not so high, no prominent, and it is small e, large a, here it is the reverse. In constrictive pericarditis, it is type 3 pattern, that is e by a ratio exceeding 2, very steep deceleration slope. This is how, though flow paradoxes is present in both conditions, in cardiac tamponade, it is early diastolic flow is lower. So think of shallow wave design, small e and large a wave. But in constrictive pericarditis, it is large e and small a wave. Flow paradoxes is invariably present in people with constrictive pericarditis. True or false? It's false. It may be absent whenever at two extremes. Whenever the venous pressures are markedly elevated, the respiratory fluctuations may not manifest, obviously. How do you make it? Doing an echo in sitting up posture, or give diuretics cautiously for 2 days and then exam, you may be able to bring out flow paradoxes. The other extreme, whenever there is intravascular volume depletion, you may not manifest that. In this situation, you can give a free challenge, give 500 to 1000 ml of saline. In 10 to 15 minutes time, you can make out flow paradoxes. This is called as occult constrictive pericarditis. I've already mentioned that during expiration, the pulmonary D diastolic velocities increase, but the systemic velocities, the hepatic venous flow, gets reversed. Remember, expiratory flow reversal in hepatic vein is an important sign of constrictive pericarditis. The ratio of flow reversal by forward flow, if it is exceeding 0.80, it is diagnostic. Now, you are looking at two cycles with the TR Doppler. Something is unusual in this waveform. Can you make it out? It gives an important hemodynamic information. Look at this. The amplitude or the TR pressure gradient may show respiratory variation. 20 millimeter here, 23 millimeter here, 18 millimeter here. During inspiration, the pressure gradient between RA and RA may differ. But look at the width of the TR signal here and here. Suddenly it becomes slender. This is a very specific feature of constrictive pericarditis. You can always match it up with what happens in cath lab. The RV pressure, the systolic pressure not only declines, the area also becomes smaller. Same thing happens with the TR signal here. It becomes wider in inspiration. It becomes wider in inspiration. So this is an important sign of constriction. Here you see pulmonary arterial Doppler waveform. There's one subtle finding which can make you to suspect constrictive pericarditis. What is that? Look at the diastole. Suddenly you get a good flow in diastole during atrial systole. You can take it. This is pre-systolic flow into the pulmonary artery because the pulmonary artery starts opening in diastole itself, pulmonary valve. This is equivalent of premature pulmonary valve opening. So remember, M mode of pulmonary valve may not be very familiar to you. This is diastole, atrial systole, A wave. This is BC, CD is the systolic component. EF is the diastolic component. This is normal waveform in inspiration or in extreme constrictive pericarditis. You can get both in inspiration and expiration, premature opening of the pulmonary valve. You can nicely see the premature pulmonary valve opening here. Doppler equivalent is premature flow into the pulmonary artery. Another 10, 15 minutes, I think I'll come to an end. What are the other causes of premature pulmonary valve opening in echo? Constrictive pericarditis is one. When restrictive cardiomyopathy is confined to right ventricle, a typical example is endomyocardial fibrosis. You can get premature opening of pulmonary valve, RVMI, Epstein's anomaly, RSOV into RV. And earlier days, tricuspid endocarditis, people were removing the tricuspid and leaving it like that. Acute TR after surgery can also result in premature pulmonary valve opening. Annulus paradoxes. Whenever the ratio between the mitral E velocity and the tissue Doppler E dash exceeds 15, it is supposed to indicate elevated filling pressures. Less than 8 is normal, 8 to 15 is borderline. But here is a situation in constrictive pericarditis, filling pressures are high, 15, 16, 18. But if you look at the E by E dash, it is not elevated. This is called as annulus paradoxes. The reason is very simple. Though E velocity is increased in constrictive pericarditis, the type 3 pattern, the E dash doesn't show a decrease because the myocardium is healthy. So obviously it not only preserved, it may even show a brisk movement. So the E by E dash will be less than 8 in constrictive pericarditis. Annulus reverses, normally the lateral velocities are higher than the septal velocities. In constriction, because the pericardium is adherent to the lateral wall or the free wall of the LV, the septal velocities will be more than the lateral velocities. The ratio of medial E dash to lateral E dash, even if it is exceeding 0.9, it is supposed to be diagnostic of constrictive pericarditis. This is called as annulus reverses. There are a few case studies. 3 weeks after SVC ASD closure, comes back with edema and dyspnea, elevated JVP, flow paradoxes. Some fluid was there, but florid features of constrictive pericarditis, postoperative constriction. With just 4 weeks of anti-inflammatory therapy, it disappeared. This is an example of transient or reversible constrictive pericarditis. Second example, 35 female, fever 15 days, dyspnea on effort 3 days, elevated JVP, classical steep X and steep Y, flow paradoxes, distinct flow paradoxes across tricuspid valve and mitral valve, expiratory flow reversal, classical constriction, but subacute onset. Trial of anti-tuberculosis treatment with steroids, the flow paradoxes disappeared. Patient showed symptomatic improvement, but the expiratory flow reversal was continuously present in the hepatic veins. But looking at the clinical improvement and the flow paradoxes improvement, I thought, she's going to make it with medical management, but 2 weeks later, she presented with more edema, nausea, vomiting, right hypochondrial pain due to liver enlargement. Again, the flow paradoxes reappeared. Marked septal bounce also appeared. So this is reversed constriction reappearing. So you should be careful. Even if somebody shows clinical improvement with your anti-inflammatory therapy, keep them under close watch for some more time to make sure that it is completely resolved. nearly 20% of the people show this sign of show this feature of transient constriction. Remember, there are some ways of identifying who is likely to show this reversal. If you have elevated CRP, if you document pericardial edema and enhancement in CMR, it tells you that it is an active inflammatory stage. These are the people who may reverse constriction with medical management. The resolution may happen as early as 10 days, or it may be delayed as much as 10 months, but you can't afford to wait for 10 months. But if it doesn't resolve in 3 months, you can take it that it is not responding to medical management, think of surgical management. The subtype of constrictive pericarditis, effusive constrictive pericarditis, conventionally it was defined as people coming with tamponade, intrapericardial pressure and right atrial pressure are equal. After aspiration, pericardial pressure comes to close to zero, but the RA pressure is persistently elevated. This tells you that there is underlying constriction which is manifesting after removal of fluid. This was defined as failure of RA pressure to fall by at least 50% or to a level of below 10 millimeter of mercury after pericardial pressure is normalized. Conventionally, it was defined like that. But we tend to see more and more cases of fluid collection, not necessarily manifesting tamponade. But if you do echocardiography, features of constrictive pericarditis, particularly like myocardial E-dash velocities showing a decline. So when you have a combination of fluid collection with tissue Doppler signs of constriction, consider effusive constrictive pericarditis. Coming to the one which is very important for you for the examinations, how to differentiate between constriction and restriction. I'll quickly go through it because everything has been already discussed. There are many similarities. They present with right heart failure, systolic function is normal, jugular venous pressure is elevated, W pattern are steep X and Y design. In Doppler, you have the type 3 pattern. In invasive lab, you have the square root sign and elevated equalized pressures. They're all similar. But what are the differences? Are you able to hear me? In constrictive pericarditis, in constrictive pericarditis, you get a standing venous column with only negative component X and Y. Here in restrictive cardiomyopathy, you have positive waves. I understand that the noise is interfering with what I discussed. In clinical examination, if somebody gives history of PND, it speaks against constrictive pericarditis. Orthopnea may occur in about one third of people with constriction. But if PND is there, it goes more in favor of restrictive cardiomyopathy. Look at neck veins. If there are positive waves, think of restrictive cardiomyopathy. If there are only negative waves with the M pattern, think of constrictive pericarditis. Pulsus paradoxus rarely be present in constriction, but never in restrictive cardiomyopathy. Precardium will be very prominent impulses, RVOT impulse, parastinal impulse, prominent apical impulse restriction. But constrictive pericarditis, precardium will be quiet. There may be apical retraction. But remember, this is an important negative sign. If there is no parastinal heave in a person with grossly elevated systemic venous pressure, think of constrictive pericarditis. Added sounds. Fourth and third heart sound in restriction, pericardial knock in constrictive pericarditis. Low pitched sounds, it's a high pitched sound. TR murmur and MR murmur may be present in restrictive cardiomyopathy, but never in constriction. Echocardiographically detected MR and TR, mild, may be present in constrictive pericarditis, but never clinically manifest murmurs. The question is, prominent fourth heart sound is a feature of cardiac amyloid. Amyloid is a restrictive cardiomyopathy. Prominent fourth heart sound is a feature of cardiac amyloid. True or false? False, because this is one restrictive cardiomyopathy where fourth heart sound may not manifest well because amyloid is going to get deposited even in the atria. Atrial dysfunction will not make the fourth heart sound to be obvious. ECG, in both you will have sinus tachycardia or atrial fibrillation. Both may manifest low voltage complexes, but if you have somebody with intraventricular conduction defects, If you have somebody with ventricular hypertrophy, think of restrictive cardiomyopathy. It never occurs in constrictive pericarditis. Look at P waves, broad and tall in restriction. In constriction, it is broad, but it is shallow. So biatrial enlargement never occurs in constrictive pericarditis. Chest X-ray, obvious pericardial calcification, small heart size, absence of prominent vasculature supports the diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis. At least this patient has some prominent pulmonary venous markings, but classically, in constrictive pericarditis, you don't have prominent pulmonary venous or upturned pulmonary Mushak sign in constrictive pericarditis. Calcification of pericardium supports the diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis. BNP, high BNP restriction, normal BNP supports the diagnosis of constriction, but there is considerable overlap between the two. Interestingly, both in constriction and restriction, atrial natriuretic peptide can get elevated. The reason is quite obvious to you. CT, thickened pericardium supports constrictive pericarditis. Something like this is there. It's very obvious diagnosis is constrictive pericarditis. But remember, thickened pericardium is not equivalent to constriction. People who have subacute pericarditis, thickened pericardium, but may not manifest constriction features at all, they may respond to medical management. So you should have thickened pericardium plus the features of restrictive physiology. Echo, 2D echo, fluid presence or absence doesn't make much of a difference. But thickness, 2D echo, particularly transthoracic echo, is a poor imaging technique to assess the pericardial thickness. Transesophageal echo may be useful partly, but CT and MRI should be done to assess the pericardial thickness. But what is important is disproportionate atrial enlargement supporting the diagnosis of restrictive cardiomyopathy, normal-sized atria, normal-sized ventricle, septal bounds, supports the diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis. And whenever you have altered ventricular myocardial pattern, look at this, something is infiltrating here into the myocardium, very classical amyloid. So when you have altered texture of the myocardium, it supports the diagnosis of restriction. It never occurs in constrictive pericarditis. MO, septal bounds and septal notches, you can see the prominent ventricular interaction here, septal notches here, does not occur in restrictive cardiomyopathy. Doppler, both will have type 3 pattern, but respiratory fluctuation will be prominent in constriction, never in restrictive cardiomyopathy. Look at the examples here. As I mentioned before, if the diastolic velocities in pulmonary vein show a prominent diastolic pattern D wave in expiration, it supports the diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis. Venous flow reversal in hepatic veins, expiration in constriction, inspiration, restrictive cardiomyopathy. TR velocity pattern, the duration of TR changes markedly, constriction, no change, restrictive cardiomyopathy. E by E dash, more than 15, restriction, less than 15, constrictive pericarditis. More than the ratio, look at the absolute values, less than 8, restriction, more than 10, constricted pericarditis. Velocity of propagation, already asked in the pretest questions, it is diminished, markedly diminished in restriction. It is normal or more prominent in constricted pericarditis. Velocity gradient, the velocity between endocardium and epicardium, normally there is a velocity gradient. Endocardium moves faster, epicardium moves a little slower. That becomes more pronounced in constriction. But that gets, decreased. Endocardial to epicardial velocity gradient decreased in restricted cardiomyopathy because of myocardial disease. 2D strain, decreased longitudinal strain in restricted cardiomyopathy, normal circumferential strain. In constrictive pericarditis, longitudinal strain is preserved, but circumferential strain is decreased. So to repeat again, in restriction, longitudinal strain is decreased, normal longitudinal strain. Circumferential strain is normal in restriction. It is decreased in constrictive pericarditis because of all around pericardial adhesions. Cardiac catheterizations, I don't want to repeat it again. will show you two examples from my collection. This is constrictive pericarditis, restrictive cardiomyopathy. The pressures are very equal. The pressures are separating out prominently here. Pulmonary artery pressures are high in restriction, normal in constrictive cardiomyopathy. But what is more important is the discordance between LV and RV pressure. Look at what happens when the LV pressure decreases, the RV pressure increases. LV pressure decreases, RV pressure increases. This is constriction. But look at what happens is LV pressure decreases, RV pressure also decreases. This is restrictive cardiomyopathy. So remember, the respiratory fluctuations of ventricular pressures are the pressure planimetrized area becoming different between inspiration and expiration is the most valid sign of constrictive pericarditis. But in spite of so many differences denominated, you may still end up with a rare case where there may be some myocardial component also, because the epicardium may get affected in some people with constrictive pericarditis, particularly radiation-induced constriction. Both myocardium and the pericardium may be involved. You may have some mixed constriction-restriction features. At times, you may have to take a bold decision of submitting the individual for surgery when you have more signs voting for constrictive pericarditis. I think I've come to an end. If time permits, we can go on for interaction. Thank you.
Sir, that was an amazing lecture. I have no words to say because I have never come across so much of pericardium so far. And actually last week, Sada was asking me, sir, we are both supposed to moderate a lecture from Dr. Shanmugasundaram. And the answer I gave him, well, now he will understand why I said that. I said, when he is talking, you don't prepare. You just have to come sit down like a student and listen. And I'm sure everybody is going to agree to that. I think it's a very exhaustive coverage of the typical postgraduate questions of the hemodynamics, how to explain what differential diagnosis for each and every point that you gave. I think everybody who's listened or who has missed it should be able to take it up on the YouTube. I think time didn't permit you to go too much into your ECG findings and other points about it. Maybe Murli should have another talk on the clinical ECG findings, or maybe Murli yourself can do the ECG findings yourself later.
There are some questions also. One question is about the management. Maybe we, for want of time, you would have restricted there, sir. But I think there was a nice question on when will you decide surgery? It was asked by Jayarajan, sir. How to decide pericarditis, means suspected TB pericarditis. The three question is TB pericarditis. So we are coming between effusion and constriction. In the disease pathology, when will you advise pericarditis? That's the question. I'm audible, sir.
Tuberculosis etiology, particularly when they have effusion as well as features of constriction, as I discussed, I think, some African studies are available which tell us that you can, institute anti-tuberculosis treatment. The usage of steroids is questionable, but we continue to give steroids along with the anti-tuberculosis treatment. I think if the clinical condition permits, we can wait even up to 3 months for making out reversibility. If suppose the features are not reversing by the end of 3 months, or the clinical deterioration occurs during that 3 months waiting period, I think you should submit them for surgery, because surgeons always feel if you give the patient early, it is easy for us to peel off the pericardium, give it to us early. It all depends on your clinical judgment. But 3 months is a good period.
Does the thickness of the pericardium also matter there, sir? Suppose you have a effusive constrictive and the pericardial thickness is more than 0.5 centimeters. Does that also matter there?
Actually, the reverse way. If you have thickened pericardium, which enhances with gadolinium contrast, it tells you that there is active inflammation, it is likely to reverse with medical management. So thickness is not going to help you.
So MRI is a useful parameter to find out the inflammation, because normally there is no late gado enhancement, and that is supposed to be a sign of inflammation in pericarditis.
One thing, sir.
you would have seen most of the time the surgeons, when they do pericardiectomy in construction, they are going to remove from phrenic nerve to phrenic nerve. The routine practice, they generally they don't try to remove pericardium in the posterior aspects. Have you seen, or is there any data on what is the influence of leaving a thickened pericardium in the posterior side alone? Is there any report on that, sir?
Not well conducted studies, but anecdotal reports say that pericardectomy should be total pericardectomy. I don't think there is a place for subtotal pericardectomy. You should remove the pericardium all around without, you know, of course, injuring the myocardium. Probably it is going to be difficult for the surgeon to do a complete pericardectomy near the atria because thin-walled structure. But the ventricle, I think we should do a complete pericardectomy because now the approach is becoming more and more median sternotomy approach. I think, you know, the complete removal is going to be possible. That situation was there in our days, like, you know, left anterolateral thoracotomy accessing the pericardium. You know, it was less than partial pericardectomy. They remove only over the LV and leave it like that, but not right.
I think the most of the fear of injuring the phrenic nerve. But it gets added to that.
Right, correct.
Any other questions? Dada?
Yeah, in the chat, they have posted a few questions, sir, actually.
Yeah.
Why there is hepatic flow vein reversal in expression in our restrictive cardiomyopathy?
It does not inspiration. In restrictive cardiomyopathy, there will be inspiratory. I do not know the reason, but you know, the few of the patients of restrictive cardiomyopathy whom I have seen interrogated the hepatic veins, I don't see a prominent reversal.
So in X-ray wise, they have questions, sir. How to differentiate pericardial tamponade versus Epstein's versus dilated cardiomyopathy? X-ray features.
Dilated cardiomyopathy, obviously, you know, you have prominent vasculature. Interstitial edema and alveolar edema do not occur in both constriction as well as Epstein's. But Epstein's and large pericardial effusion will closely mimic each other. I don't think there is a real way of differentiating between the two. Even in Epstein's anomaly, you have small aorta and small pulmonary arteries. Vascular pedicle will be narrow. It's a water bottle shaped contour in both.
There is another question, sir, regarding clinical tamponade, echocardiographic tamponade, and hemodynamic tamponade. I think it is extensively discussed now.
I think already mentioned.
We have discussed extensively. Yeah.
Even in the echocardiography, one feature precedes the other feature. So maybe the right atrial collapse first, right ventricular collapse, then pulses paradoxes, like that, it progresses.
So this is from YouTube, somebody has posted. Low pressure tamponade, how to differentiate? Low pressure tamponade.
If you have somebody has, pericardial fluid collection, you exhaust, investigate the patient completely. You make out pericardial fluid collection, the patient is sick, hypotensive. Physical examination definitely may not show elevated JVP because the filling pressures are low, but pulses paradoxes may manifest in this individual. This is the way of suspecting clinically. But echocardiographically, you will have all features. Clinical setting is important. Somebody with malignancy, malignant pericardial effusion, chemotherapy, dehydration, vomiting because of the chemotherapeutic agents. Typical setting is that.
Almost we have answered all the questions which have been raised. We have answered all the questions, sir. Sir is having another question.
Another question, sir. Would you like to comment about how to recognize impending tamponade in the cath lab?
I think keep an eye on the pressure monitor. I think that's the way. The one tracing which I showed, actually Ilayaraja was doing the case. So my case, he was doing it post dilatation, little larger balloon. That was a wrong choice. Larger balloon, patient did not complain of anything. I noticed the drop in pressure. I cautioned him, like, you know, something is happening. Look at that. You know, then it turned out to be coronary artery perforation. But settled down.
Yes, sir. We have this question is yes. From the arrhythmia side. When we do ablation for flutter, atrial flutter, many yes. times, yes. what you are doing, there are episodes of vagal stimulation. There may be a sudden fall in pressure. There may be some bradycardia also. But flutter patient already having a different type of rhythm. The point we use is, apart from the pressure, sir, look at the RAA border. Oh. Earlier, you are rightly showing that RAA border is the first buying, the movement will stop. So, the astute thing is, keep a watch on the initial RAA border register. The moment the RAA border movement stops, you can be sure that occurs even little above before the pressure part. So, you have to be prepared. And an echocardiogram is a very, very valuable tool while doing intervention in the cath.
May I add a point, sir?
Yes.
The, after coronary interventions, the last shot, what Dr. Samir Sharma says, is to take the low max shot in RAO cordon. Okay. That is the best shot to look at the RV apex. So that that particular shot, if you take a CINI, you'll clearly able to delineate with the injection. There's a significant gap between the pericardium and the epicardial vessels. They are going to be away. So that is the reason why he always stress the last shot should be RAO cordon low max. So that we can see left main dissections and perforation if there's going to be effusion there.
Another question is this. Does pericardectomy result in normalization of JVP in patient with constrictive pericarditis? Is there any effect of pericardectomy on JVP in normal person?
Normal persons, you are not going to do pericardectomy.
I don't know why they are, but anyway, I think after pericardectomy, the JVP is going to settle to normal.
You know, if it is a complete pericardectomy, it should decline.
So another, somebody has to told to repeat square root sign. We have a YouTube link, actually. You can watch the YouTube link. Sir has extensively spent time on explaining the square root sign. So those who have missed, please connect to YouTube and you can watch the entire lecture, entire series of webinars. We are continuously, it is available in YouTube. Always, you can check again.
Thank you, Tiaram. Thank you, Prabhan. Thank you, Bhuvadi.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. We should all thank you for the excellent lecture on pericardium, sir. I've never heard so much about pericardium. Learned quite a lot.
Especially your old 20 years back M-mode pictures are really phenomenal, sir. Excellent, actually. We are very thankful to you for showing all this.
Thank you.
One thing I have to state here. I know Tupla sir from 1987. Sir's enthusiasm in teaching hasn't come down even by a fraction of percentage. Thank you, sir. You always remain a great teacher to all of us. It's my pleasure to record this in this meeting. Thank you very much.
Well, good thing you changed the topic also. You initially gave me pulmonary hypertension. It would have been a little stale, like, you know, the pericardium matched with my expectations. Thank you.
Pericardium is more dynamic for you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you everybody, thank for your active participation. And I think we should call the meeting to a close.
Thank you.
This is the coming schedule.